And I specialize on this particular topic wherein I go to a lot of corporates across India and I train them on this topic. And I've also written a book with real life incidents of sexual harassment at workplace from different industries. It's a story-based book which actually gives learnings at the end of it for learning for employer, managers and for victims as well. Yeah, how they can handle it better. So that's the experience about backup of myself. So want to understand what is the objective, why you are here? Are you a CEO of an organization or what was the purpose of you are here? Quickly.
So I have a new company. We have just spoken about a year ago. We are making sure that the compliance part is addressed.
How many of them like this?
Yes.
For compliance are they doing now?
Yes.
Okay. What would be your team size?
Right now, what? 15.
15?
30.
30. Okay. And you are the HR with you?
Yeah.
HR? Wonderful. Okay. So let me get that that part of the case. Your understanding on this topic, a quick check. True or false? Okay. How many of you think it's true? True, raise your hands. False, you don't have. But it's not a crime. Sexual harassment is not a crime. False, everyone agrees that? Okay. Great. Either way, I will not be impacted by this law if I don't harass anyone. Set the context, there is a law called prevention of sexual harassment for women at workplace. Okay, it protects the women. So I'm a male, so I'm not impacted. Is that the right statement?
Sounds like a fair statement.
Background noise.
But my voice, okay. I don't hear my own voice.
You can use your mic, please.
That'll be better?
Yeah, that's a bit better.
Okay, so this is not comfortable with recording, thanks.
No? Okay. So Uber, Susan Fowler, how many of you are familiar with Susan Fowler case? Can you speak to me? More better about her?
The Uber case?
Yeah.
I think people are aware of it, but she complained that the environment was very hostile to her in terms of the kind of jokes that were made by the engineering team and passes that, advances that were made. So, and she wrote a mail about it.
A blog. She
wrote a blog about it, yeah.
So this was a case about a single employee who took to the social media. She just wrote a huge blog with a name put under it, and that grabbed a whole lot of media attention. Her name was Susan Fowler, and she was an intern who had joined the Uber US office. And she said, the last 1 year, I've been asked for sexual favors, and I tried complaining with the HR. They just shoved it under the carpet. No one acted on it. So, and I'm not the only victim. There are multiple victims to this. I cannot take it anymore. Hence, I'm writing this blog. And that created huge attention. So as a result of it, Uber was asked to hire an external auditor to do a complete audit of their thing. Then they figured out not just sexual harassment, there were a lot of other non-compliances that they were doing. They were having some driverless cars without permits. So all these things, and as a result of it, 16 global CXOs were asked to leave. And as a result of it, the Indian's counterpart, the CEO of India Uber, was also asked to leave. Why? Because he had a sexual harassment case in his previous organization, which was a clear black mark on his record. So they wanted to clean their slate completely, because it was a huge negative thing, brand image was like that. While Uber was busy cleaning up their internal dirt, another competitor called Lyft, L-Y-F-T, grew up in one, and she called herself Indian Fowler. Of course, in India, you have a taboo around the whole topic, right? So because of that, she called herself Indian Fowler, and she wrote, police came out and said that, please write a file, an FIR, come out and file, only then we can take action, otherwise we can't take, anonymous, we can't take action. But the point is, to her blog, there's so many other people who responded saying, even I have been victim in this organization where I've been victim, CEO has harassed me. And it's a case against the CEO. And the funniest part was, in response to this, the CEO immediately gave a press release to say, this is a false allegation, I'm not going to accept this. And someone from an anonymous person, it's completely false. And if I find a woman sexy, I'm going to call her sexy. He told us in the media. This clearly brought out that startups are not really familiar with the compliance. He was not even aware of the act. No compliance was followed in one employee organization. And law very clearly states any organization which has more than 10 employees have to be compliant. Right? So that is what this thing brought out, and similarly all the other cases. So now this guy behind the UBIQS, he's resigned now. Arnav Kumar. So similarly, we've had cases of Scoopoo, where this R.K. Pachauri, a Nobel laureate, Peace laureate, they held out a very long ago case. Okay, they're not compliant with all these things. So the damage that it causes to the brand image, just want to highlight, so why should we really be bothered about compliance? One single mail by your victim or your customers in Twitter, media is just waiting to grab such news. Okay, the impact that it causes to the brand image, as a result of which all the employees are not going to feel good about it, your customers are not going to feel good. Another example of that, Fox News, okay? They had this Bill O'Reilly Factor show. He was a huge hit, one-hour show he was doing. A huge guy, he had multiple books and a famous guy, personality. He had multiple sexual harassment cases against him. And when this came out in light, for that one particular one-hour show, there were some 60 sponsors who withdrew the sponsorship. Kind of impact. And they had to shut down that show. Right? The kind of impact. Now customers, and they are realizing the importance of it. They don't want to support harassment, and because media is talking a lot about it. Right? So just wanted to highlight the impact of the whole thing. Okay, let me quickly run. So what is the case of it? Because they talk about harassment, the
brand image logo, but are there really victims? Okay. So what are the statistics you think? So in the workplace, a statistic shows that 22 out of every 100 have been victims.
So business statistics show different number, but it's always been 22 to 30% are victims at workplace.
And again, 5 of the victims are men.
So men are also victims. 2% were same-sex harassment.
So that is also on the rise of late.
Though law does not protect the men, your organization policy can be made gender neutral, wherein it goes and protects the male also, which we highly recommend, because policies can supersede the law, right? And when you make it gender neutral, your employees are going to feel protected, they're not going to be threatened, that only women are getting all the extra privileges, so that's not going to be there. So make it gender neutral, that's what we said.
Any questions so far?
So we'll be moving on.
Okay, so from the survey, another finding was that 46% thought only physical advances were sexual harassment.
Was only physical touch or anything to do with that sexual harassment? What else could be sexual harassment?
Verbal.
What else?
Messages.
Offensive comments.
Again, verbal. What else can be?
Gestures, right?
Physical, verbal, non-verbal, talking, something that being portrayed in the movies, right?
So, those things. We have to be watching out for everything, gestures. Okay, so these are some of the things that we need to talk about. Impact of non-compliance against is the law part.
Law clearly says if you're not compliant, the first time penalty is going to be 50,000. Second time, you may lose your license to execute your organization, run your organization.
So you may ask me, so how is the law going to find out? How is the government going to find out? Right?
Anyone raising a complaint, for example, when the Indian Collar case happened, they clearly saw that TiE was not compliant with the law. Right? And this whole law comes under the Ministry of Women and Child Development, Meneka Gandhi, comes under Meneka Gandhi's department. So anyone from the Women's Commission, State Commission, can come and raise a petition and ask people. Right? Yeah? That's not the definition of sexual harassment. What is the definition of sexual harassment? Very clearly, these three things qualify. See, you may call physical, verbal, non, those are different forms of harassment. But is it a sexual harassment or not? How do you identify that? Very clearly, these three points, anything that is unwelcome, sexual in nature, and impact not in there. The last point is something that you will have to really, really look out for. The question when I said, see, I'm a male, I don't harass others. Right? You're not bothered? It's not the right thing?
See, you may think that shaking hands, I shake your hands, so it may not be a problem. The same way I go shake hands with this gentleman, my leg, why is she going to shake? The kind of cold, I'm not comfortable. The intent was just to shake hands. But the impact on this individual is different from that individual. The impact that's causing this person, right? So that is something that matters. Women are very almost as well. I'm creating cases around women because that's the majority of cases that we are handling. Women are all the more sensitive to touch. They know which is good touch, bad touch, they easily identify. Sometimes the unintentional things that you may do may lead to cases. If the lady or the victim feels impacted, it could be any case. Okay, exist in workplace, would that be fine? Yeah? So two individuals having a consensual affair at the workplace, is that a problem? So you also see, you see that two of your employees are having an affair. Would it trouble you?
As long as it doesn't affect the work.
As long as they are professional, they maintain professional behavior, they don't do the PDAs at work and disturb others. You're saying you're fine, right?
It may not be a crime, but okay,
it may
not be ethical.
It may not be ethical? You think it's not ethical? Two adults having a consensual relationship, not ethical?
But in three cases I've seen, they just follow up after some time and then one fights
the case
again.
See, okay. Very well, that's coming to that. Exactly, exactly.
What happens is, initially it is welcome, after that it becomes unwelcome.
Exactly, exactly. That is the point, okay? So, but the point is, till the time it is welcome, I'll see you if you go and question them.
It's a problem.
What does it want to say? They're like, what is it? Why do you? And two adults having a consent to whether it is marital, extramarital, or whatever, not our problem. Right? We can't question their moral thing and all things. Two adults, it is their problem. Right? So we can't question their rights.
But
as long as they are impacting the work for others, creating a hostile environment for others, you definitely have the right to question, because it is going to lead to harassment. This person getting impacted. Point two, it breaks up later. Okay, the relationship breaks up later and then someone's still pursuing. Then, let's say I'm having an affair with Srilata. Okay? What an example? Those are, come on, we are living in modern society, right? Things are coming up. So later I break up, Srilata does not even want to look at my face, but then I like Srilata, I'm pursuing her. It is clear case of harassment for Srilata now. She can always raise a complaint against me, right? So we have to watch out for these cases. And organization, for this reason, we tell them that in case you are having a relationship, please inform your HR. So people know what's happening and tomorrow if something goes wrong. There's something called relationship policy or dating policy.
Why should we be tracking individuals?
Very good point. Why should we have to track it? Okay?
Because we have to. It means that we have to keep track whenever they're breaking,
Only thing is you need to track it. They have to report it if they have a reporting relationship. Okay, let's say a senior person is having a reporting affair with a junior person. Okay, so what's happening now?
Performance advisor
or something. He has a conflict of interest will be there. Can influence, so other team members are now feeling impacted. They're like, this person is going to obviously favor that lady over there in the team, so I'm like, kind of anyway, whatever I'm going to work, it is not matter.
It is not encouraged.
You have to put them in different projects. See, they just have to inform and move to different projects, not in reporting relationship. That's the only thing.
Part of the HR policy that they are expected to inform the HR?
Yeah, ideally a lot of companies don't have the policy, but we recommend that you don't have a policy like that.
What is the policy?
You can call it dating, there are a lot of companies that call it dating policy or relationship policy.
Really?
Relationship policy, or see relationship.
Reporting, yeah.
No, reporting, yeah. See, the thing is even siblings for that matter should not be the same thing.
Okay.
Correct? Relationship. Any relationship. Blood relationship, spouse, or then you have the conflict or you tend to favor them. So that's the general rule a lot of organizations have, relationship policy.
Relationship policy.
So even this, if you're having an affair, this again becomes a clause under that. You can add the clause saying whether you're having an affair with fiance or okay.
So I have a question. Basically,
due
to certain reasons that have happened in an issue, you've introduced this relationship policy where you say that we ask them to come forward declare if they are in a confidential. Now, for example, there is a little breakup and one of them files a sexual harassment case against the other. So how does this in any way protect us, or how should we take them forward in case of investigation? How does that work? We have this here. And,
what happens is the severity of the recommendation that you give to reduce, that's the only thing. Right? When that is not there, it only looks like a one-sided harassment kind of thing, right? But at least it was a mutual relationship and then it's gone. So then you give a warning and say, the person is not like it, please stop it. You just give a warning and let it go. But otherwise, if you're not aware of the history or the background, then you might be forced, if she has different, stronger proof or something, he or she has strong proof. It kind of influences your recommendation. That's the only thing that
helps. But still, we will have to do the same kind of investigation.
Same kind of investigation has to happen.
Policy applies only where the official boundaries or where they are an official work. That's where it matters. And beyond
office.
They're
having an affair?
Yeah, no. It kind of breaks up and then it's following up and all that.
Okay, then, see, if individuals coming back to office, right? Still, it's like they have to face each other. So it's just causing hostile environment for them. So that is the only thing. Okay, and very clearly, law also states that. The name of the law is Prevention of Sexual Harassment of Women at the Workplace. So something happens in public, you don't have any control, right? I'm walking on the road, someone comes and pass me in the back, and I can come and complain to my HR. I don't even know who the third person, you can't act on it. So the only option that I can do is I go walk into a police station and file a complaint saying in this road something happened. So reporters can take some kind of action.
If employees are having this outside the office?
Yes, I'm getting there. So if two employees are having it outside the office, so again, when they come and complain, so this is a private party they went or something, and the residents something happens, you really don't have to act on it. So the committee need not take it up for investigation because it becomes a headache, right? You start taking up, so, and this we typically recommend for bigger organizations, because one case they take up, someone else might come up, some between couples they might have some issue, they might come and complain. It was a real headache, and this committee that's handling this case, that's an internal committee every organization should form, which will handle such cases. It becomes a headache for the committee to handle such cases. But these two are not a full-time job, it becomes a full-time job. So, but these two individuals are your employees, they have to face each other. From that perspective, you let the HR to handle it. The committee cannot handle it, legally you're not bound.
What if we, let's say, we are going out at a party as a company, like an event?
Exactly, I was coming to that again. Wonderful point. So, what is the definition of workplace? At the workplace, law says. Workplace is any location where you are bound to be there by virtue of your employment. If your employer has asked you to travel there. So, as part of my employment, I'm here. Okay, so this is a conference, right? Or I typically come and travel to client place and do a session, right? So that kind of thing. You ask the employee to travel to a client location or team building party that you're doing, official project party, correct? Those are all official workplaces, even those are workplaces, even the extended workplace, this is a workplace. Okay, so those are counted, you have to handle
it. Sponsored by company,
the virtue of it. Okay, so next question, that's workplace definition. What is the definition of employee? All are protected by this.
Everybody,
what about contractors?
Contractors, yes, everybody.
They're protected?
Yes, yes, they're extended to anybody sitting here.
Yes.
Perfect. That is the reason when I said I have all male employees, I'm not impacted, that's a false statement. Because even if I have a housekeeping staff or courier delivery person visiting and files a complaint, it has to be taken up at hand. Your workplace is your responsibility, you have the onus to protect anyone who works. So very clearly, definition of employee law states even a daily pay employee or anyone even hired without the knowledge of the principal employer is also protected under this act. So anyone walking into your premises is protected, right? Be it contractor or employee.
So what if an employee with two employees and one of the employees that is stalking the other employee which happens outside following? So will that not come under?
So one is like something like a risk path, right? Where multiple organizations will be working, right? So in such cases, do you have such cases where one employee is following the other one and something happens goes wrong? So this committee of this organization A will work with the committee of the organization B. We will work together and solve the case.
So which means the ambulance is outside office. So that will still be
outside office. See, if someone is still talking within the office, see, in such cases, outside the office, HR can handle it, the committee need not handle it. HR can intervene because they are employees.
The same organization, right?
Same IT part.
Say my company has two employees.
Something happened outside, so I addressed this earlier. The thing is, you are legally, your committee, internal committee is legally not responsible to handle the case. Something outside the workplace, it's not in the workplace. Because this committee has other responsibility to work on. This is not their responsibility to handle it. So legally no one can question them. Right? So maybe the HRs can intervene and probably they can do the same kind of investigation, but as the HRs go, they can take. Because two employees, if they are having hostile, they can't face each other. So it's good that you can intervene. There are some organizations like Infosys and all where they take it up as part of the purview of IC only and they handle it. But they are told for all cases that come in, but that's the form that they are taking. Right? And that is a stand, mutual stand that you take, follow the same rule across.
Excuse me. Most of these cases I have seen a challenge, which is, you know, trying to get the initial evidence. So we have CCTV, surveillance cameras, money in common places, but not in, you know, individual gatherings.
Right.
Okay, so how do you handle privacy versus getting evidence and then information security, cyber law, you know, they talk
about it. Very clearly, and I'm clearly saying impact versus the intention, correct? So let's say, I go and raise a complaint.
Like that perfume thing, you know, you might have meant perfume. You have complained, you know, you're saying, I'm smelling good.
Right. So simple things like, I'm saying, this gentleman patted me on the back and he walked away. I think no proof at all, for there was no CCTV or nothing, right? It's just my word against this.
Yeah.
But But and as we all know that there was no proof while you were doing that, you can deny the whole thing completely. But I don't want to let go. Just because there's no proof, I don't want to stay silent also. Right? I just don't want to bear with it. So in such cases, what we recommend is when there are certain processes to help you do the investigation. And these are civil court proceedings. This committee, by having been formed as part of the organization, by being part of the committee has civil powers. Okay? So, and there has to be, there needs to be a third party person also who has to be part of the thing. The reason is that it's unbiased and fair hearing is given. So when a complaint comes in, there's some step that we follow. So various kinds of legal kind of thing where in court when they call you, how do they do it? So whatever I tell, answer will Allah moon mind, or they say the oath, right? Similarly, you will have to do the same thing in your workplace also, which creates a very solemn environment. And people know it's very serious. They can't lie. It's like when you're saying and you're asking them to sign a confidentiality agreement and a self-declaration and saying that they are telling the truth, when they're signing that, later proven wrong, it's like the value is wrong and you can take action on that. So it's very serious that if you do follow the procedure, you have a third party person, three of them sitting on the table and investigating, 95% of the cases people agree, acknowledge it in the first instance itself. Very few cases it goes multiple rounds. So you will have to follow certain thing and you will have senior people, mature people handling these kind of companies. That really helps.
So is it okay to, you know, save all those video meetings?
Yes, yes, definitely. And there will be a lot of other things, 60 days, 90 days, so 30 days is the only thing that you save, right?
How long, how long is the duration? Like from the incident to complaint?
Okay, so law again states that within 90 days someone has to raise a complaint. But that's not restricted, okay? So there have been complaints that come in saying that, okay, last year, this simply happened when, during the appraisal time or promotion time, okay? So let's say the promotion cycle is completed and I've got a bad rating. In such case, I go on raising, I've got a bad rating because last year I proposed, my manager proposed to me, I refused, and that's the reason he didn't give me a promotion now. Valid case or non-valid case? We don't know, maybe. Maybe or may not be. We'll have to check the performance records and everything and justify the whole thing.
Actually, I want to talk about that case. Like, when somebody proposes to someone and somebody does not agree to it, does it account to harassment? But that itself, because it's a gray area. What is harassment?
We saw the definition. What is harassment?
Impact on the other person.
So
the impact on the other person.
But that's also kind of impact, right?
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah, but it's like,
see, I'm like, see, this workplace, why are you coming and proposing me? I don't like it and this behavior, I say, I'm going and complaining. Okay? So, I see committee is there, I go and complain. In this case, maybe the first instance, see, and not all instance lead to termination. In this case, I'm not like it. It's not confident again. We always recommend people that confident and speak up. If you don't like, tell them upfront. Don't come running to the IC every time. But there's nothing stopping you to come. So people could be hesitant. We should understand that people are from diverse background. What if the boss is kind of proposing? You might not feel comfortable going and confronting the boss and saying, no, don't do it. Correct? So always approach the IC. In this case, first time only one instance, IC may give the warning or apology and ask them to be serious, then you ask. You do a lot of other penalties and all those things are there. Correct? So in such cases, people do ask me in my session, people ask me that. So does it mean that even if we genuinely like someone, we should not even propose? It's very true, right? Very valid point. I tell them at the risk of your life partner or your job. And see, the jokes apart, you do get some vibe reciprocated, you do get some reciprocated vibes back, right? So look for, watch out for all those things. If you get those things, then take an attempt to propose the person, right? So those are the kind of some of the some tips and tricks to those kind of things.
So,
just for the benefit of time, let me quickly finish this.
Employee from another company, the same
in the food court, right? Two different employees from different parts.
Different.
So, I'll handle and ask the question, quickly run through these things, and then I'll address those points, okay? So, okay, role of an employee, what are the things, very important thing in case you're not compliant, these are some steps that you have to ensure that your organization is compliant. Any organization, any location, branch which has more than 10 employees, should have a committee created. Okay? So you need to have a policy overall, preferably have a gender neutral policy. Constitute a compliance committee. Okay, rather internal committee is the name of it. call it internal committee, and it has to have at least three people who are headed by a senior women, and the fourth person should be a third party person who knows the law. And for third point is create awareness for your employees and for your internal committee. This committee is also just your employees, but the point is committee should know how to handle the case, the legal aspects of it.
All members are women.
Women, 50% should be women. 50% definitely should be women. Or majority women. Okay? And then the law does not say that one person should be at least male. It does not say that, but it only says 50%. So it can also be an all women thing. But ideal thing is have a one person gentleman, definitely, because it's easier when you do invest, I mean the inquiries and all those things. The male person, because most of the time the perpetrator is a male. So it's easier for them to answer. So all three ladies are sitting and he feels the person feels threatened. That itself is a that's a harassment for the person.
Can CEO be part of the HR?
We don't recommend the CEO to be CEO, has to stay out of it. The reason being CEO will be an appellate authority. If either the victim or the respondent is not happy with the investigation that's happening, they can always go and escalate it to the CEO. The CEO can either change the committee or set up another fresh committee and do a fresh investigation as well. Okay? If they're not happy with the CEO, another second round of appellate authority will be a sessions court. They can take it to court always. Okay, they can appeal it further.
So our internal committee has taken a very senior lady and two women and one male and one external party. Are we good? Yeah. And how often should the internal committee meet?
We don't meet every quarter. They should be meeting every quarter whether you have a case or not. Every 3 years you change the committee.
So every quarter we meet and we find saying no cases.
No cases, you discuss the best practices, any other prevention mechanism that is there, what are the things that's the general pulse of the employees, are they aware of it? Check the general checkpoints.
One more quick question. Now the awareness, would you say at what level should be more aggressive? Okay, we do this as part of you know, awareness programs. We talk about voluntary sexual harassment policy, encourage them to come up when they have any concerns. So that means that which level do you think we need to create more awareness?
Okay, all levels definitely, yes. Induction, a new joining, please do great.
What I'm saying is most of our most senior people should be our focus here because
see it can happen at any level, but we typically when I go to do sessions for the clients, I tell them do a classroom session for your senior management and an online training is also okay for the other employees. Because senior management really set the culture of the organization. And they are the ones who are closely working with the team. They know the pulse of the team. They know what is the right behavior. If someone is not comfortable, so they can approach them and talk to them. So those are the things that they have to do. So set procedures that they can follow basically in case. And always, people are not comfortable going and talking to HR. They are always comfortable going to their manager and complain. Right? So managers need to take more responsibility. Okay, quickly moving on.
So what's the annual report?
Okay, the last one is annual reporting. So I was talking about one point where how does the government track? Someone tracking you. So there are two ways of tracking. One is January to December, all organizations have to file, any organization which has more than 10 employees have to send a report to the District Labor Commissioner office. In your letterhead, only the three points. Three points are going to be X number of cases came in this year, January to December. Y number of cases were closed, Z number of cases are open. That's it. Sign it, CEO and presiding officer, the head of the committee, so sign it and send a courier or email ID. Keep a copy with you, saying that you're fine. Similarly, another report, where else you all, how many of you, if you're 1 year old, if you find your IT returns, you would have noticed that in your director's report, there's a director's report, there is a section on this topic, small paragraph which says same thing again, how many cases came in. So typically even auditors are not aware of this, they just fill it nil and then they give it to you, you just sign it off and give it off. This has been there from 2015 and this report goes to the registrar. From that it gets tracked to the National Women's Commission. They track it and in their annual reports they have filed saying how many of the cases have come. Sad part is last financial year, across India, only 5